So I'll begin the recording. Vinodi, just confirm if you can see the presentation on my screen.
Yes, I can.
Okay. Is it clear?
It's clear.
Right.
You're able to hear me and see me?
I can. Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining us today, this evening, for what promises to be an informative webinar at the very least. I'm joined by Vinodini Srinivasan. She currently practices at the Bombay High Court. Before that, she was a senior associate at Keystone Partners, Mumbai, and prior to that, a business analyst at McKinsey. Vinodini, is anything else you want to say to introduce yourself?
No, I think that covers it. Thank you.
Okay, a few house rules. There is a written Q&A that you can ask. We'll be taking that, the questions you write in the written Q&A, both at the end of the session, and some of them we'll of course be answering during the webinar, during the conversation with Vinodini. After the webinar, we'll also be having an open Q&A where you can raise your hand. I think on the top left, there's a raise hand option. You can raise your hand and you can directly ask Vinodini or I a question. We'll just enable your mic and, you know, you can directly ask us. So just setting the base, why are we doing this webinar? Quite frankly, at Legality, we got a ton of questions. Almost every week, or every few days, we get a question on 65B. And we realized there's a lot of confusion out there. There's a lot of uncertainty out there about Section 65B. And there's also a lot of curiosity about how the latest judgment that the Supreme Court passed a few months back changes things. So we decided what better way than to conduct a webinar and actually commission the writing of an ebook, which is what we're going to send you along with the recording of the webinar after this. And I think based on attendees, most people signed up just for the ebook after the webinar. But hopefully they'll see the recording after as well. Okay. So I think we can begin. Vinodini, any words from your end as to why exactly this topic is relevant today?
Yes. So I would think there is a lot of discussion on 65B online. But if you were to see the thrust of all those videos, it's mostly on whether the judgments that have interpreted 65B have done so correctly, or whether they are the best possible interpretation of the law on electronic evidence. I think today we should look at another question, which has been the source of primary confusion, which is, what is the law on 65B? Let's for a second forget whether it's ideal, whether it can be improved, but what is the law? And if I have to produce an electronic document in court, particularly an electronic agreement, and prove it, what do I have to do? Those are the simple questions that we are going to be answering today.
But I remember when planning this webinar, you told me you don't want to start with 65B, you want to start straight from the basics.
That's correct. So I think if you see the judgments on 65B, you'll quickly realize that the framework that the judges are using to interpret this section is coming from general evidence law. So let's actually spend a minute just looking at what the general law on proving any document is. Paper-based documents have to be proved inevitably through their original, right? So when you have a paper-based document that you have to prove, then unless you fall under certain specific exemptions under the Evidence Act, you do have to produce the original before court. You cannot, as a matter of right, produce a photocopy and attempt to prove a document. This is something we're all familiar with. It's only where either the original is not available or it's very voluminous and therefore cumbersome to produce, all those exceptions being set out in Section 65 to the Evidence Act, can you produce secondary evidence, which could be a photocopy, which could be any other form of actually producing a copy of a document. This is important because what this shows is, even in general law for paper documents, when you do have to lead evidence of a copy, there are some procedural hurdles that you have to cross called formal proof. So you will have to file an affidavit of evidence setting out certain things. So let's say you can't find the original of a letter and you want to produce a photocopy. Your evidence affidavit will describe what is it that you want to produce in evidence. You would say it's a letter, how it came into your possession, then you will have to say certain things as a matter of course. You will have to say that you searched for the original and you are not able to find it. You will have to say that you asked for a photocopy of the document to be taken when it was available with you. You will say that you had compared this photocopy with the original, and you will say that the copy is an accurate reproduction of the original. The point of making you say all of these things, which some of it is honestly quite obvious, right? Of course, you would say a copy has to be identical to the original. But even then, the law requires you to say these things. The purpose being that these averments show the authenticity of a copy. Now, it's through this lens, really, that I think we need to look at 65B of the Evidence Act. What 65B does is that it translates this law on formal proof and modifies it to a certain degree for electronic documents. Let's first look at the paradigm that physical documents set up. The whole point of proving physical documents is inevitably you have to produce the original. But if that were the law on electronic documents, it would actually be quite inconvenient. Because what really is the original of an electronic document? Let's take
my phone.
Precisely, but let's take an example, right? Let's say I write you an email and saying, let's please schedule this webinar at 6 p.m. on Thursday and not 5 p.m. on Wednesday. Let's say, where is the original of this document?
I know that it's stored on Gmail servers. So would it be the Gmail server?
That would certainly be one place where you have the original, but obviously that can't be produced in court. What else? Is there any other place?
My inbox, is that a device or my laptop? I mean, what is the device? Or my phone. If I access it on my phone, I could access your email on my phone.
Yes, pretty much every device that you would access your email directly on. And also my device from which I sent the document to you. So unlike a physical document of which there is only one original, even when we are talking about a simple document like an email, we are able to come up with four originals where they could potentially be. Of course, we don't yet have a judgment to say, no, it's only X which is the original or Y which is the original. But reading the judgments that we do have, it definitely looks like if I were to actually produce my email on my phone or on my laptop or on an iPad today, I could do so. But that is a very cumbersome way of asking people to lead electronic evidence. If the court had insisted, as it does with physical documents, that you need to produce your laptop in court every time you want to prove your email, electronic evidence would just not be as simple to prove. 65B, the key departure, therefore, that 65B makes from the general law of evidence, it's to say that you can produce electronic documents in certain forms, let's say a photocopy or a printout, a CD or a pen drive.
Yeah.
Correct. You can produce it in all these forms as a matter of right without producing the original. That's the one radical simplification of evidence law that 65B has brought about.
Just one slight observation here is essentially, this all stems from the fact that really there is neither an original nor a secondary copy with electronic evidence. Even though we need to fit them into buckets to meet our paradigms, there actually isn't. Who's to say a digitally signed document on a USB is less original than something stored on my computer? And I think that's where 65B comes in.
Yes and no. So when we discuss it and when we analyze what an original actually is, we do hit this stumbling block. But if you look at the cases, they do seem to think that what is on the server is an original and what is, once you print it out, it's not. Or if it's on a pen drive, it's not. It should be on the original device to be called an original.
Right.
Right. So 65B is essentially a process to let you bring a printout or a pen drive or a CD on record. It's as simple as that. Now, we just saw...
So do you want to come to the act now or do you want to go straight hop to Anwar versus Bashir?
Let's hop to Anwar versus Bashir.
So tell us a bit about Anwar versus Bashir.
The idea of Anwar versus Bashir is this. If there are certain hoops that you have to cross, even to bring the photocopy of a physical document on record, 65B sets out those formal averments or procedural things that you need to state to get an electronic document on record. What Anwar versus Bashir did was that it crystallized those formal conditions. What is it that you have to set out in a certificate under Section 65B to make your electronic document admissible first? The second important thing that Anwar versus Bashir did is that it said a Section 65B certificate is mandatory. But before we go into the aspect of the mandatory nature of Section 65B, let's first look at what are these conditions that Anwar versus Bashir set out.
Right.
Now, if I were to actually read these conditions to you, they look pretty obvious. So let's look at the electronic record must be accompanied by a certificate, that's your 65B certificate, which identifies the record. Of course, how are you going to lead evidence of anything without telling the court what is it that you're giving evidence of?
And this is true of any evidence affidavit. I mean, even primary evidence or secondary evidence that is not electronic, you would have to identify what the record is.
Of course you would. The second is the certificate must describe the manner in which the electronic record was produced. Now, this is not something very complex. So let's imagine a simple document like an email. Judges understand what emails are. They're not expecting you to set out a full technical review of how emails work. But let's say you were producing, for instance, a legality agreement. That is something a little more unusual that a judge may not have come across till now. So you will, in very simple terms, say that legality is an online platform. It facilitates online execution of agreements. You will say that you have an account with legality through which you can access the agreements that you have executed. And that is how you have accessed the agreement and downloaded it before printing it. As simple as that. The third condition is that you must describe the particulars of the device involved in the production of the record. Now, let's say you are going to give a certificate of an agreement between you and me executed on any online platform. You are going to print it using your computer, so your device is involved in the production of this record. You have to set out the model, the make of your computer, and similarly, any printer that you are using to actually convert this document from electronic form into physical form. So the certificate will literally describe that this is the computer I used, and then you will also say that this is the printer I used to take a printout of this document. Now, the fourth condition is that
the fourth condition seems a bit complex to me.
Yes, and it's created quite a bit of confusion. But at heart, what this condition is saying, that you must say that your computer or the device that you use to create this record, or for that matter, print this record, are both devices that you use in the ordinary course of business. So there's nothing really unusual about them. And why are you doing this? You're mostly giving this assurance to say that these devices were operating correctly at the time that you produced the record and now at the time that you're printing the record. Why is it that you're saying this? Really, just like in a photocopy, you went to the extent of saying that you've compared the copy with the original and the original matches the copy. What you're really saying here is that there was no defect in my printer or my computer, which was of such a nature that the printout that I'm producing is somehow different from the original on the computer. You are not being asked to say that your computer was functioning perfectly at all points of time, merely that there is nothing wrong with your computer which will make the copy that you are eliciting from it different from the original which is on it. It's a very simple assurance that you're giving in condition four. The final condition is condition five, which is who has to give the certificate. If it's your laptop, say, you will give the certificate. If it's your company's laptop and you are using it, it's a work laptop, you can give the certificate. Or your network administrator can give the certificate. Really, anybody who is occupying some sort of responsible position in relation to that device can give the certificate. So if you actually look at Anwar versus Bashir from this perspective, what they're asking you to set out in the certificate seems quite simple.
So, I mean, two obvious questions from a practical enforcement standpoint really pop up to me.
Sure.
So the first three conditions seem pretty self-explanatory. I have a question on four and five. When you say the computer must be used regularly to store or process such information in the ordinary course, what is confusing me right now is, does it mean that this computer must be used for the kind of document I'm producing. I'll tell you the context, right? Often, say someone could get a document produced, say if they need it, there's a last minute, they may produce it in the, I mean, they may print it out on another printer. It may not be like they may print it out. I mean, they may produce the document on one device. They may print it on a printer, which they usually don't use to print it. Either friend's printer or the printer in a printer
shop. At a printing shop. Yes, you have to set out
the office.
So 65B is not asking you to to personally go and take out printouts. You can procure a printout through somebody else. But yes, you do have to describe the device that you have used in the 65B.
Okay, so you just have to attest to the fact that, look, this is a printer that is used for printing things. Yes. I mean, it's a valid printer. This is the model. This is the make. So it's a legitimate printer.
Yes. And then it's being used regularly in the course of business. This is not an unusual application of that device, so to say. It's a printer. I use it to print all the time. That's really all you're saying.
Understood. So it is not that this printer must be, so all my loan agreements or all my business contracts, it's not that I must use one printer to only print.
No.
Okay. The second question I had is when you talked about number five, the certificate must be signed by a person occupying a reasonable official position.
Yes.
So does this have to be my network system administrator? Because usually what happens is, you know, there will be one witness for, say, a company. Yeah. There will usually be one primary witness. Do they need to get a separate witness for the electronic record, or can that same primary witness attest to this as well?
Let's say, Patel, it's you. You drafted an agreement. You uploaded it on Legality's website. Then somebody in your organization signed it who is authorized. The other party also signed it. And now you want to produce it in evidence. You download it on your laptop. You print it using the printer that's available in your office. You can produce the 65B because you are occupying a responsible position in relation to the device, the laptop which was used to actually download and print this document. Because in that sense, you are operating that laptop regularly in the course of business. It is your work laptop. So you are entitled to give a 65B.
Okay.
It's not that somebody from the IT department must always do it.
So it really doesn't change. The 65B really doesn't change the natural flow of evidence that people follow right now. It just is a additional gate pass, so to speak, which describes the technology used that has to be produced along with your evidence affidavit. And
the change that it brings about is that it removes the burden on you to produce the original at all costs.
Right. It simplifies things. It allows your electronic evidence to come into your regular evidence flow of your physical documents.
Yes. That was really the objective of 65B, although it's now reached a state where it's discussed in a state of confusion. The intent was to make it simple to prove electronic evidence.
And I think, I mean, largely the case law, which we'll be discussing shortly, or at least the current position, really does affirm the position you just described.
Yes,
it actually simplifying things.
So there's been a lot of up and down, but this is the position of law as we speak today.
Okay. Now let's cut to the chase. The number one question we receive.
Sure.
And I think you may also receive as a lawyer is a section 65B mandatory?
Yes.
And if it's yes or no, why is there so much confusion around a simple answer?
Simply because there have been so many Supreme Court judgments which have decided this question so differently. The first was really the judgment in 2005, the parliamentary attack case, when they were asking themselves how to prove Afzal Guru's call record. There the court said, look, a 65B is not mandatory every time I want to prove an electronic record. We talked about those ingredients of formal proof that you might want to resort to prove a photocopy. Yes. So there's Section 65 of the Evidence Act, which sets out several such procedures where you can make secondary evidence admissible. All they said was you can follow any one of those procedures. You don't have to follow the procedure under 65B. But in 2014, Anwar versus Bashir, which is the case that we just discussed in the previous slide, said that that's not the case. A Section 65B certificate is mandatory. 65B is a special procedure that has been set out for proving electronic records. So you cannot prove an electronic record the way you would prove a photocopy. You have to follow the procedure that the law has set out under 65B, and you have to produce a certificate under that section. So suddenly, from not being mandatory, 65B became mandatory again. Now, to add to this confusion, in 2015, the Supreme Court in the Thomas O'Bruno case went back and referred to the judgment in Navjot Sandhu, the 2005 judgment that had been overruled by Anwar versus Bashir, without referring to Anwar versus Bashir. So suddenly everyone was wondering, so is Section 65B mandatory or is it not mandatory? The next important judgment is the judgment in Shafi Muhammad in 2018, where the court looked at a very interesting problem. We've been talking about till now about documents that you have access to on your computer. It may be an agreement, it may be an email. Right. But what if it's a document that I don't have access to? What if it's a CCTV camera footage of a camera maintained by somebody else in some other building or in a hotel or by an election authority? How then do I provide a 65B certificate? I can't, because the electronic source is not with me. Shafi right. Muhammad said, in such cases, you should not be compelled to provide a 65B. How will you? So they said 65B can be relaxed where required in the interest of justice. They left it to the court to relax 65B requirements wherever appropriate. It was really this judgment.
Okay. So like an Airtel CDR, like a call record or something like that, Shafi Muhammad basically said it's not in your possession. So
yes.
Don't produce
a 65B. So the court may waive these requirements in the interest of justice. So they realize that it's not going to be possible for you to produce the 65B. They say it's not required.
So what, I think that brings us to Arjun Pandit Rao. I mean,
that's correct. Now. That squarely brings us to Arjun Pandit Rao. Arjun Pandit Rao has basically negated that position, overruled the position in Shafi Muhammad and the three cases at the bottom of the screen. And what Arjun Pandit Rao says is two things.
What were the facts? I think the facts here would actually illuminate the situation the court had to deal with and distinguish from.
So very interesting facts. It was an election petition, and the election of a Shiv Sena candidate was being challenged. And the challenge was that he hadn't filed his nomination in time. He was supposed to file it before 3 p.m., but he in fact had not. And to prove this, the challengers were really relying on CCTV footage in the returning officer's premises.
To show that he had appeared actually after 3 p.m.
That he had filed the nomination papers at 3:53.
Right.
They had the CCTV footage. There was a small two-line certificate that the election office had given saying this is from our CCTV camera. But nothing that met the requirements of 65B. Challengers in this case repeatedly tried to get a 65B. They sent a summons through court. They made several demands on the returning officer. But the High Court in this matter, in fact, observed that the election office was intentionally not providing it. Now the question is, in the absence of a 65B, can that CCTV footage be admissible in evidence? The Supreme Court said two things. First, the Supreme Court said that a Section 65B certificate is mandatory to prove any electronic record. And for this, their logic was very simple. They said Anwar versus Bashir is a judgment of three judges. Shafi Muhammad is a judgment of two judges. Shafi Muhammad cannot modify what Anwar versus Bashir says. Anwar versus Bashir is the law. So you do need a Section 65B certificate for any electronic evidence to be admissible. Second, when do I produce it? This is again something that has been even a subject of newspaper headlines, that somehow Arjun Pandit Rao says you have to produce it at X or Y stage. But in fact, all Arjun Pandit Rao says is, as a matter of course, you will have to produce it at the stage of evidence. In civil commercial trials, which is what we are really talking about today, what would be the stage of evidence? The stage of evidence would be when the court asks you to file your affidavits of evidence along with your compilation of documents before it goes into marking of documents. So that's very clearly when trial is about to start, when you're about to start marking documents, when you're filing your affidavits of evidence, that's when you will think, you realize that it's time for me to now produce my 65B.
Right. But basically, a good rule of thumb would be, I guess, whenever you need to file an affidavit, because I know in some section 138s, you'll file the affidavit in the beginning when filing. And so basically, whenever you need to file the affidavit of evidence is when the Section 65B also comes.
And some courts, I mean, of course, the procedure varies widely across the country. And given that we're speaking to so many people, the procedure does vary from court to court, state to state. But a good rule of thumb is either when you're filing your affidavit of evidence or the court asks you to file all your compilation of documents for the purpose of marking documents, that's a good rule of thumb. You should file your 65B certificate at that stage at least. But having said that, Arjun Pandit Rao did leave discretion to the court to allow a 65B to be filed later if the certificate is defective or if you're relying on a third party to produce it. And of course, conversely, which would mean that in a trial, a judge may even say at another stage that you need to produce a 65B because he wants to see the authenticity of the electronic record before him. That discretion has not been taken away by the judgment in Arjun Pandit Rao. This obviously leads us to the next question, which is, but what about the problem that Shafi Muhammad dealt with? What right. if I don't have access to the electronic record? How will I get the 65B?
Right.
Here the court said, I'm not going to dispense with this requirement like Shafi Muhammad did. What I'm going to do is ask you to do what you would do for a physical document that's not in your possession and you need it in evidence. They said, send summons through court. The court can always send summons to another party to produce any document before it. So if you need call detailed records from Airtel, ask the court to issue summons to Airtel to get these to get a 65B. Or alternative, try to procure it yourself. And which would mean that just like you would do for any physical document, send a notice to produce to the other party to produce a 65B. Now that leads us to the next question, which is what if they don't produce it?
Right.
That is in fact what happened in Arjun Pandit Rao precisely. As we were discussing, the election authorities refused to produce a 65B for the CCTV footage showing that nomination papers had not been filed in time. The court right. then said, the court looked at whether the parties had made every effort to get the 65B on record. In that case, they had. So it said, I cannot compel a party to do something which is impossible, where they've made every attempt to procure this document and they've not got it. I cannot then say that the CCTV footage is still inadmissible in evidence. So they said in such circumstances, where it becomes impossible to procure a 65B, despite every effort, applications, notices to produce, letters, summons, everything, then in those cases, we will dispense with the 65B requirement.
Okay.
So the threshold is fairly high. You have to make
interesting. Effort. Interesting. Yeah. So as, say, me in legality or if I have an email client, should I as legality be expecting, you know, my clients to send me notice to producers or applications to produce a 65B? I mean, do I fit into that where I have possession and they don't have possession?
No, I certainly wouldn't think so. If that were the case, in fact, then every time you produce an email, I'd have to go to Gmail for a 65B certificate. That's not the case. That is because both with legality and with emails, the user has access to the electronic document on their own computer. And therefore, they can print it and they can set out all those averments that Anwar versus Bashir required quite simply. The second reason that I would give you to say no, legality doesn't have to furnish the 65B certificate, the user can, is Section 65B3, which says, okay. Yeah, would you want to show it?
Yes, let me just show that.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yes. It says, where over any period, the function of storing or processing information for the purpose of any activities carried on over that period, as mentioned in subclause 2, was regularly performed by computers, whether by a combination of computers, different combinations of computers operating in succession. The most important part is the last part. All the computers used for that purpose during the period shall be treated for the purposes of this section as constituting a single computer, and references in the section to a computer shall be construed accordingly. So that's very similar to what happens to a legality document. A user will originate it, he will put it up on legality's platform. That document will then be transmitted using the code that legality server has to the recipient, who will sign it. It might come back. Then it's hosted on legality server for either party to download and print. So the document, the signed document, has really been produced by a combination of several computers in succession, which would So by a deeming fiction, it's as though it's been produced by one computer only. So as the user, as one of the signatories, you can give a 65B certificate for the document.
So interesting. That ties into a question we received in the Q&A. I think I just quickly popped to that, even though we'll be taking it all at the end, but I think it ties in, it's very relevant to this discussion.
Sure.
And this is my earlier question of what if I print it at a cyber cafe or I send it to my lawyer and they print it.
You will have to say in your 65B that you procured a printout under your instructions, so you'll have to set out the device that was used for printing it.
So does this in any way change who has to sign the 65B? So if I give it to a lawyer and their clerk prints it out on their device, do I need to change? Does the clerk or the lawyer need to sign? Or
I wouldn't think so, because a 65B is usually given to the best of your knowledge. So you can definitely say if the document is originated from your computer, it's now being printed by somebody else. So long as you point out what the device is and you say that to the best of your belief and information, that device has been working properly and is used regularly for printing, you should be able to give a 65B certificate to that effect.
Right. So, all right. So, I mean, so that's 65B then. I mean, that's
65B. Yeah.
Okay. But it doesn't end there, right? I mean,
no, 65B, it
doesn't. I just produce a 65B, I produce my agreement, court accepts my 65B. I don't automatically win the case or at least get my evidence.
No, you don't. Because 65B in that sense is just a gate pass, so to say. It's a threshold document to make your electronic document admissible in court. Now, prove your original physical agreement just by producing the original physical agreement? No. You would go on to prove the signatures to that agreement, because that shows that both parties have accepted that agreement and it's become a contract. Similarly, with electronic agreements, you will have to prove the signatures of both parties to that agreement. Here, two things to keep in mind. Several platforms have really two ways of executing documents electronically. You either do so through an Aadhaar eSign or a DSC. These are recognized as electronic stroke digital signatures under the IT Act, and they carry with them certain evidentiary presumptions that we will discuss. The other way of doing it is through, let's say, email authentication. You get an OTP on your email ID, you type it out on the link to the agreement that the platform sends you. The platform then considers the agreement to be signed. Or alternatively, you get an OTP on your phone and you do the same thing.
I just read out a question we received because it ties into this discussion. Would it be admissible evidence to prove a click wrap? I mean, what would be admissible evidence to prove a click wrap agreement, and more specifically, contract entered by simply a OTP method? So that would, I think, fit into this.
Yes, that's really the question we're answering right now. I think the most important thing to keep in mind at this stage is there's nothing really preventing you from entering into agreements by entering OTPs, or even by not doing any of this and simply exchanging the terms on email. The law recognizes all these as valid acceptance. In the end, what you have to show is that the other side accepted the contract that you sent them. The only difference is in the ease of proof. And I think it will help to first talk about what the presumptions are when it comes to Aadhaar and DSC sign before we come to how to therefore prove the other agreement.
So I think here we talk about 85B, right?
That's correct.
85A, C, A, B, C.
Yes, 85A and 85B primarily. So under 85A...
Here it is.
Yes, there it is. So it says, 85A says, the court shall presume that every electronic record purporting to be an agreement containing the electronic signatures of the parties was so concluded by affixing the electronic signature of the party. Electronic signature is a defined term. It's defined under the IT Act. It is any signature... includes the digital signatures, and it's any signature which has been recognized by the government under the second schedule. Currently, only Aadhaar eSign is recognized. So once you have an Aadhaar eSign...
There is a PAN-based eSign in the works. There is a PAN-based eSign, but not very commonly used, but that's also recognized.
I see. Okay. So when you have such a signature on an electronic agreement, there is a presumption in law that the agreement was actually concluded by the parties affixing their electronic signature to that document. The second consequence, which comes from 85B, is that your DSC sign, Aadhaar sign, these are all, they are secure electronic signatures, which means that every change made to an agreement after you sign will be tracked, and it's not easy to tamper with these documents. Therefore, the law presumes that where you have signed these agreements using such a signature, the document has not been tampered with. And somebody who claims that it has been tampered with will have to come up and show that. The third important thing is that if there is an electronic signature to an agreement, the law presumes that the subscriber of that electronic signature affixed his electronic signature with the intent to sign that agreement. So effectively, when you have an Aadhaar e-sign on an agreement and you produce the electronic signature certificate along with it, which will show who the subscriber to that signature is, the law is effectively presuming that he signed the agreement, and he signed the agreement with the intent to sign that agreement and accept the agreement. And even finally, of course, it also presumes that the agreement has not been tampered with.
So in what that means is, if the other party wants to dispute this, so what it essentially means, if I'm not wrong, correct me if I'm wrong, is I just need to produce the electronic signature certificate, which can be available on the PDF document.
Correct. Along with a 65B certificate for that electronic signature certificate.
Now, if the other party wants to dispute it, what the presumption means is that they need to lead evidence. They need to put someone in the box. They need to adduce facts to disprove that this is a valid signature.
That's correct.
The burden goes on to that side. Okay.
Yes. And that's
But this is not the case with the other type of electronic authentication.
No, it's not. It's not. If you were to adopt any other mode of signature, e-sign, virtual sign, it's called so many things, you will have to demonstrate that the other party accepted the agreement. And you may do so. Now, before we say this, right, let me first point out that doesn't mean that this is cumbersome or you shouldn't adopt these modes of signatures. Because in ordinary commercial disputes, if you've actually legitimately entered into an agreement, it's highly unlikely that you don't have a trail of correspondence where both parties have acted on that agreement. Or for example, if you're a bank disbursing a loan and have signed a document using a virtual signature, you would have actually credited that loan to the other person's bank account. So the scope for saying, no, I never accepted this agreement, I deny everything, that sort of a case, it's not going to be the only limb on which most cases will stand. But having said that, in law, yes, you do still have the burden to prove that this agreement was executed. And you will have to do that. What the platforms do to make it easier for you to establish this is that they give you an audit trail. And I think Legality also does that. There they literally tell you what the trail that was followed for the execution of this agreement. So this person opened his phone on this IP address, accessed the link at this time, got the OTP on this number, entered the OTP at this time, executed the agreement at this time. So you have an electronic document that actually sets that out. So does that mean that this alone is sufficient? Let's just go to the next slide.
Yeah.
So do I just have to show, if I produce my electronic agreement with a 65B certificate, and I have I also produce a printout of the audit trail, and I provide a 65B certificate for the audit trail, am I through? That's the question. Here again, let's step back and go back to what evidence law has to say on how do you prove documents? There are really three steps to proving any document. First, you have to show the court what the document says. That's called proving the contents of the document. So how do you do that? By producing the document itself. If it's a physical document, by producing the original or producing a copy after meeting and skipping all the hoops that the law sets out for you. If it's an electronic document, by producing a 65B. So now you've produced a document before the court. The court sees the document and says, reads the document and says, all right, what this document says that it is saying is what it actually says. You're proving the contents of the document. Second, if there's any.
So really, 65B only really gets you through number one. 65B only actually gets you from one to two.
Yes. That's correct. Nothing else. Then you prove the signatures on the document if there are any, or if it's a handwritten document, you might want to prove the handwriting. Now, for an agreement, that's enough. Because after that, you're going to read the terms of the agreement to see what it says. You don't need any oral evidence. But let's look at some other types of documents. Let's say I write you a letter saying legality is excellent, and you want to use that in evidence.
Right.
That's my...
I can't say, simply Aadhaar e-sign it and use that to prove it.
That's correct. Let's say the agreement has my Aadhaar e-sign. You produce the letter. You produce a 65B certificate. You produce my electronic signature certificate. That just means that you have proved that I have written a letter saying this. That doesn't prove that legality is excellent. The truth of what I have said in that letter has not yet been established. In fact, at this moment, it's hearsay. Just by producing a document where I have said this, you don't prove it. If you do have to prove it, you will have to ask me to lead oral evidence on your behalf. I should be willing to undergo cross-examination to say that, no, I do say that legality is excellent. So the truth of the contents of what a document says do need to be proved through additional oral evidence. Again, if this paradigm becomes applicable to audit trails, then things would become more difficult. Because who has personal knowledge? Who is the author of the audit trail? When I sent you a letter, I told you legality is excellent. I would have certain facts in my mind to attest to that. I am the author of the letter. I can depose to the truth of the contents therein. An audit trail is not like that. Nobody has full personal knowledge of what the audit trail has exactly set up. You as legality don't sit and see each customer entering their OTP. You certainly can't say that the contents of this audit trail are to my personal knowledge. Each party, this is an electronic agreement. Nobody's going to sit in the same room and do it. I can't say that I saw the other.
We can't see anything. I mean, we can't see the OTP. We don't have access to it.
Exactly. So if the law did require you to lead oral evidence to prove the contents of this audit trail, things would become quite unnecessarily difficult. This is where the Delhi High Court's judgment in a case called Kundan Singh is in fact very relevant. What the Delhi High Court says is it speaks of other automatically generated documents, of course, not audit trails. And what it says is that you don't, in fact, need oral testimony to prove the contents of automatically generated documents. That's because automatically generated documents are not an assertion that anybody is making. It's not like a letter. Nobody is saying stuff. This is content that's been automatically captured. This is not hearsay. And therefore, you don't need oral evidence to prove it. All you have to show is you need to produce this document along with the 65B, and you need to show that the content in there was automatically generated, that which you will do by through a witness. And that's it. And then you won't need to lead further evidence to prove. The document is proved at that point.
Just a quick question. Then the audit trail, though, really, I mean, given the presumption of validity that's there for, say, a secure e-sign, like Aadhaar or DSE. There the audit trail's importance does diminish. So, I mean, this point of proving the audit trail really becomes critical if it's not a secure e-sign.
Correct. So, if you had Aadhaar e-signed a document or you had digitally signed a document, you would just produce the electronic signature certificate. What else do you need to show? And execution is proved then and there as a matter of legal presumption. It's only where you've used OTP or some other means that you might want to produce the audit trail. But one caveat at this point, Kundan Singh has not yet been tested in specific with respect to audit trails, but this is a useful judgment to keep in mind if you have proved your document or if you have used virtual sign to authenticate documents. Having said that, audit trails are not the only way to prove the execution of a document. There will be emails exchanged between the parties. I believe legality itself sends emails to its customers attaching the signed agreement. So there are all those
sometimes, not necessarily. I mean, there are multiple ways to do it. And in fact, not just legality, I mean, across platforms, there are multiple paths that can be followed by anyone.
So evidence of those paths is certainly admissible and you can certainly give it. There is no difficulty. So you can always file an affidavit of evidence saying, this is the email address of the other party. I put it on this platform. This platform automatically sends a link to that party. And then I received an email from the platform automatically confirming that this party has in fact signed the agreement. All those emails can also be produced to prove exactly what you're proving through the audit trail. So, but it's useful to keep in mind that the Delhi High Court has taken such a progressive view of things and has discussed something. In fact, if this were to be the law of audit trails, it would mean that the law on electronic evidence has really
simplified.
Come on its own. Yeah, correct. It has progressed.
But of course, naturally, it means to be tested.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
As it's a nascent, I mean, I think e-contracting generally is in a very nascent stage.
Correct.
But I'm sure discussing it
as
an option,
as something that as lawyers, we should certainly keep in mind when we are trying to introduce such documents into evidence and are met with frivolous objections from the other side.
And I think it's exciting also in a sense that lawyers actually producing this in court are at the frontier of actually, you know, testing this proposition out.
Without a doubt. Yes.
All right. That's quite helpful. I think, yeah. So Vinodini, I think we can go straight to the questions then.
Sure.
Is there anything else you wanted to add or cover?
Not quite. Unless you do want to show that paragraph in Kundan Singh, I think it's worth a read.
That's true. So actually here, one thing we also missed out on, I think when we were discussing 65B, is showing the sample 65B. But first we'll come to Kundan and then we'll go to the sample. So this is from Vinodini's ebook that she wrote for us, which you all will be receiving along with the recording.
So paragraph 56 of Kundan Singh, which is in the judgments are all hyperlinked in the ebook, says this: electronically generated record is entirely a product of functioning of a computer or a computer process, like call record details or a fax report, which shows the number from and to which the fax was sent, time generated, etc. It does not contain any assertion. Therefore, as noticed above, it is not hearsay. Normally, non-assertive conduct is more reliable, provided there has been no fraud or interpolation in the preparation of the record. Computer-generated telephone records are not similar to a statement made by a human declarant and therefore cannot be treated as hearsay, and the credibility and evidentiary value is determined on the reliability and accuracy of the process involved. Ergo, in these cases, when the conditions of 65B are satisfied, the probative value or weight can be substantial, of course, subject to verification as to the credibility and integrity of the content. So what this means is, just like if you are producing call detail records, you don't actually have to call an officer from Airtel to say, yes, this call was placed at this time on this day. You just have to produce the call detail records. I would assume that this judgment can be very useful in introducing audit trails also in evidence.
Interesting. Kind of bringing it in line with technology.
Yes. Correct.
Which is increasingly networked, server-based, automatic.
Yes,
it's increasingly automatic.
Track such activity, and that tracking becomes immensely useful when you later have to introduce it in evidence.
Interesting. So another thing we missed out on, I remember you told me you wanted to quickly
run through the sample 65B.
A sample 65B. I mean, I think we don't have to spend so much time on it. I think that you just wanted to highlight how the conditions of Anwar versus Bashir really fit into a document. Someone have to type?
So what we've done to make things somewhat simpler is provided a sample 65B that you can introduce along with an electronic agreement.
Yeah. Just a caveat, this is we have to choose an example. So we've chosen an e-signed document through legality, but the same concepts would apply for other electronic records as well.
That's correct.
You either have to change certain language around depending on the context of what record you're producing. If it's a CCTV or if it's a email that you're producing, the governments would slightly be different.
Obviously, yes. So very simply, as you see, right on top in every affidavit, you have to say who's affirming that affidavit. That has to be a responsible official with knowledge. Then you will quickly identify what is the document that you're producing a Section 65B of. In the case of a legality agreement, as we discussed, simply because such agreements are not widely seen by judges day in and day out, you will also say that it's available on this domain. You will give a brief description of the manner in which this agreement has come to be. So you will say that legality is a platform where such agreements are generally executed and then they become available through an online account which you have, which is also protected by a password.
Sure. But I mean, sometimes they may download it from the account straight after it's sent, and they may then just store it on their server. That's also fine, right?
That is also fine, in which case all you have to do is say that.
Okay.
Yeah. And then you will go on to point out what is the device that was involved in the production of this record, and where is it that you're printing this from. And for that, you will have to set out the make of the computer, the serial number. If you have a Mac, you will say that I have a Mac of this model, and the serial number is so and so. You will then say that this is being used by you regularly in the ordinary course of business, and it's not suffered any issues which would be of such a nature that the printout that you're taking today is not an accurate reflection of the document that you downloaded from Legality. And second, you will also describe the printer that you are using to print the document. And you can very well say that the printer procured by you, the law does not require you to physically go to the printer and print the document yourself.
Right. I mean, I can get someone to print it for me. I mean, usually yes. Businesses also, that's the case. There'll be multiple people doing
it. But you do have to describe the device, the printer that you're using.
Sure. You basically need to attest to the court, show the court, like, look, this is the document I'm producing. This is how I am actually produced the document. Like, where did I get it from? And what machines were used along the way. I need to tell the court that this is the specification of the machines used along the way. And I have
speaking to the source and authenticity of this document. So you are really describing the journey of this document from the time it was electronic to the time that it has become a printout. And you are telling the court that in this journey, there were no interruptions, technical or otherwise, that would have resulted in the copy not resembling the original. And therefore, you will finally say that you have, in fact, compared the electronic document with the printout, and it's identical.
Quick question. Do I need to produce a separate 65B for each thing? Here it says an agreement, but if I have 10 documents I'm printing out at once for use in court, and that's usually how it happens, right? Like, yes. I'll be printing out all electronic records from a common device.
Yes.
Multiple electronic records. Do I need to really have a separate 65B for each?
No, that's not required. You can include multiple documents in the same 65. You will just have to add additional paragraphs for each document, setting out the relevant averments. So let's say you were to, in fact, I believe even this sample 65B includes averments on the electronic signature certificate annexed with the document.
Yeah, there you go. I think so. Audit trail, I think.
Yeah. Audit trail. So all of those documents you can very well produce with under the same 65B. There's no difficulty.
Perfect. Okay, that's great. So shall we come to some of the questions that have been asked in the chat box? I think we answered some of them, but I think it would be useful for everyone if we recap them, even if we've covered it, that there's ultimate, like, utmost clarity. We want people to leave quite clear about these concepts.
Right.
So the first question, I think we covered, would it change things if I used a computer at a cyber cafe or another device for the conditions in Anwar? Second, of course, if I send it to my advocate and their clerk prints out the document.
I think in the latter case, no. But in the former, there is, of course, a challenge in terms of asserting to the fact that the device was used regularly or it's functioning properly, etc. But having said that, Anwar only requires you to say these things to the best of your knowledge. So you can, I would think that it's more challenging than if you were to produce it from your own device, for sure. Because objections can be raised that you're not occupying a responsible position in relation to that device. You don't really have knowledge of how the device works. So the cyber cafe example is, to my mind, a little more complex than...
businesses really won't face an issue.
Businesses are going to be accessing it through their own computers. It's unlikely that today, in this day and age, you're not even accessing a document through your own phone, but you're accessing it through a cyber cafe. But if that were to be the scenario, then yes, there are some complexities there.
Right. So we have another question.
Yes.
Second question. In case the laptop belongs to a company, I mean, very common companies, is it mandatory for the IT head? I think similar to a question I had asked you over the network administrator. Is it mandatory for the IT head to sign the certificate? But the second part of this question is, isn't it better for him to sign? Even if he's not required to sign, is it not better that he signs it?
It really depends. If you are producing documents from several computers that are a part of a network, or you're producing, let's say, some logs, etc., which have been extracted by the IT department, it really would depend on what is the document that you're producing. But I would imagine if you're introducing an electronic agreement on the record, you're a bank official, you uploaded the template, you got the signature of your boss, you got the signature of the customer on that document, you want to print it and produce it in evidence, there is no real need for your IT head to give a certificate. It's your work, you can give a certificate.
So someone in my department got the signature, I am just the authorized signatory, or I am just the authorized witness, that also wouldn't impact it. I can still sign to it if I have knowledge, information and belief, if I've received that.
If your device was involved in the production of that record, and you are now producing that record from your device.
No, I mean, I'm a authorized signatory or authorized witness of a bank. I mean, I may not be...
Of course, you were involved, right? You signed this document using your device.
Okay, but what if I'm not the authorized signatory and I'm just a bank official who knows things, because authorized signatory can leave the company. I'm just their successor.
That's all right, because you're going to be accessing... You have access to the bank's password. You have access to the legality account. You're going to be accessing that account, or you're going to be accessing your own platform, bank platform, to download the document and to produce it. And you're going to be using it, doing this with relation to an official system that you use for your work purpose.
But I'm not the one printing it. I'm sending it to my lawyer, or someone is sending it to the lawyer to print it.
That's okay.
You know, I'm just getting someone in my department to do that for me.
That's all right. But the person on whose device this is, as a thumb rule, the person on whose device this is being downloaded and who's giving a printout is best placed to give the 65.
Okay, so it would be a simple matter of just printing it from the device of who's going to be producing it.
IT head can do it, or some other functionary in the bank can do it. I don't think that should make a difference. But the person should be able to depose to those things which are set out at the
center. Sure. So then, I mean, even if it's not from my device, if I'm a responsible bank official, say I just came in later and I was briefed on the matter, because that usually happens, right? In a lot of cases where a witness really changes or they've left the company. So when in fact, in Indian court system, when they produce the evidence and then when they actually are cross-examined on the evidence, there could be a change. No issues there, right? I mean, there's no issue with normal evidence, so I don't see.
You are the person who's now becoming, in that sense, the official on that matter, and you are going to access the bank's legality account, download the...
No, it's already produced in court. It's already produced in court by the old witness.
In that case, of course, it would be better if somebody who was around at that time did it, but there, I don't see a particular difficulty if the bank official who is currently on that account deposes to all these facts on the basis of whatever, to the best of his knowledge and information and belief.
Right, because that's what happens for non-electronic evidence as well.
This is true of almost all evidence, right? Even when you have to put a witness in the box, you will always ask yourself this question: should I really lead the evidence of a witness who has knowledge, or can I use somebody else who has just joined the organization, who is more junior, who might have more time? To be fair, I'll have to say that if possible, please do produce a certificate by the person who is best placed to produce it. Does that mean that the others can't give a certificate? No, they'll have to avert to these facts to the best of their knowledge and belief, just as Anwar said. So long as they are connected to that agreement or to that matter in some form, they are handling that account, for instance.
Okay. Sorry, am I back?
Yes, you're back.
Yeah, sorry. Just small disruption. Okay, the next question is, so basically, I mean, what I want to draw is the fact
that... Sorry, you're getting cut off, Patel.
The same difficulties and the same secondary evidence. Sorry, I think I'm back now. So what I wanted to highlight is that Hello.
Yes, I can hear you. Go ahead.
Yeah, yeah. It's not uniquely electronic evidence is not some special.
No, see, these are challenges.
I mean, there's a special different procedure under 65B.
So let's say you want to depose to conversations or the contents of emails that were exchanged between a bank official and a customer, and that bank official has left. You are going to be in a place where the person who has come in his place has to lead evidence. Is that ideal? No. Is that impossible? Certainly not. You will be able to produce the documents, and he'll have to attest to the best of the extent that he can on the basis of documents and really to the best of his knowledge.
Right.
It's the same case with the 65B. If you can give a certificate from a person who is actually in control of that device and who has knowledge and who is involved in the production of the document, please do it. But if that's proving to be extremely cumbersome, then you can settle for the next best option. That's not a problem.
Right. Right. Okay. Next question. I can see a few people have raised their hands. So just
give your voice is getting interrupted.
5 minutes will come to you. But the next question. I think it should be better now. Can you hear me?
Yes, now I can.
Yeah. So if there's an email exchange, who, between, say, so I'm a lawyer, there's an email exchange, and between my client and a third party, if I print and file the affidavit as a lawyer, do I sign the certificate? Hello.
Yes, I think you were disconnected for a bit.
Can you hear me?
No, I can't. I can't.
Yeah.
Just look at the question.
I didn't say anything. Yeah. Yeah.
So if my client sends me emails exchanged between my client and a third party, if I print and file the affidavit, do I sign the certificate? So this is a question that most lawyers do have. General practice is to give the affidavit, to give the 65B from the client's end. So that's the general practice. At least, perhaps, because it's not your laptop that is involved in the production of that electronic record. And it was the client's laptop that was involved in that process.
Okay.
So it's best to give it from the client's end, unless it's unavoidable that you have to do it from your end. What would be admissible evidence to prove a click-wrap agreement and more specifically contract entered by submitting an OTP? So we discussed this. It would really, if you have an audit trail, certainly the audit trail, and also other messages that the platform would send you and the general correspondence that you would have to show that this agreement has been executed. It's going to usually be exchange of correspondence, even subsequent correspondence where the party has admitted the agreement. Okay, so I see a question on criminal matters. So this discussion was primarily about
civil commercial
matters.
Next question.
Yes, sorry. Okay, I'm just going to read the question out, I guess, till he comes back. The next question is, in case a criminal matter is pending against an employee of a company and certain electronic records need to be produced, is it better for the IT head to sign and not other cross-functional heads? One, this discussion was largely on civil commercial matters. I must confess that this was not about criminal matters. And so I think this is, it's best left to an expert to answer. I would think that this is actually very dependent on context, what kind of documents you're talking about. I don't see any blanket thumb rule that it's better for one person to produce over the other. But I would imagine that the question perhaps comes from the view of a local court and what courts are comfortable seeing. So it would be best for somebody who practices regularly on the criminal side to answer that question. Often documents are forwarded by, okay, I think this we got. okay, if you could please discuss 85 of the Evidence Act again. Let me just see if you're able to share it. Patel, are you connected? Will you be able to share 85A?
Yeah.
Yes. So 85A says that the court shall presume that every electronic record purporting to be an agreement containing the electronic signatures of the parties was so concluded by affixing the electronic signature of the parties. So what it says is literally, if you produce an electronic agreement and it appears to have electronic signatures, which will of course show, one, by the face of the document itself, and two, by annexing the electronic signature certificates, then the law presumes that the agreement was concluded by both the parties by affixing their electronic signature to that agreement. So essentially, it's a presumption of the signature and the identity of the subscriber. What would be secondary evidence if I lost electronic data due to virus attack or by other means? If you do have a backup, then you will have to produce that. If you don't have a backup, it's a tough question to answer, because 22A of the Evidence Act says that you cannot lead oral evidence on the contents of a document. So it will be interesting to see whether you are allowed to say that this document existed and it in fact said this. I would presume that the law would not allow you to do that. So unless there is a backup or there is some other way of producing the document, there was a printout which was taken at that time, and you want to introduce that in evidence, say, that is, it's going to be a fairly difficult circumstance to deal with. Let's look at call records. So I would not want to comment on regulations specific to fintech companies, but having said that, the question is really, for how long should, in case of call records recorded by fintech companies, for what period should the record be kept as law? I would really not want to comment on what is specific to fintech companies, but there is a direction in Arjun Pandit Rao for call records to be retained. So let's just quickly, do you have the judgment with you, Patel? What the court says is that, in fact, appropriate rules should be framed by the central government to determine the manner and the period, etc., for which it is retained. But there is a general requirement, regulations will be framed for which will stipulate for what period this data has to be retained. To the best of my knowledge, for now, there doesn't seem to be any specific fresh regulation that's been passed actually setting out the number of years for which it has to be retained. At least nothing that I am aware of. how to prove consent for documents which are revised automatically. Will a checkbox declaration suffice? Okay, so if in case you are you have an agreement that you have to click to enter a website or something like that, then that's good enough. Yes. This is going to be the case with most online websites, etc. This is not really an agreement executed on a platform, but really is a standard agreement that you will have to agree. You will have to say that I agree to that the terms and conditions are accepted even before you enter the website. At best, you might have to produce a screenshot of your website saying that this person has agreed and has indicated his acceptance of the terms and conditions even before he entered the website. That's how you will have to prove that the terms and conditions, your standard terms and conditions, have been accepted by that other person. So there's a legal presumption in favor of the validity for recognized e-signature methods such as Aadhaar-based e-sign, as opposed to something like exchanging emails. Is that correct? Yes, that is correct. Aadhaar-based e-sign, digital signatures where you have that code on your pen and you use it to insert your digital signature on a document, all those enjoy legal presumptions in terms of evidence. But exchanging emails, entering OTPs, authenticating your agreements through any other form do not enjoy the same legal presumptions. You will have to actually prove that both parties accepted the agreement.
Right. So I think we have a hand raised, but I'm not sure if I'm just allowing them to talk. So if you have a question, you can speak. If your question is already answered, I mean, no obligation to speak. But we'll throw the floor open. I think anyone who has any questions that you want to directly ask Vinodini.
Yes.
Hi, Shivani, you can speak. Yeah.
Yeah. So my question was specifically in regard to OTP related contracts.
Yeah.
So in case of OTP, for me as a third party who's taking consent from a customer, it's very difficult to prove that I want to understand what all safeguards would I require if I'm taking consent through an OTP. So there are transactions which could have implications.
Are you talking about an online platform?
Because I'm talking about an e-commerce platform, any online platform that takes consent for providing various services.
Maintain an audit trail much like your platforms do. So if you were to see any major platform that executes e-contracts today through an OTP, they do provide, in fact, virtual sign, for instance, is nothing but OTP authentication. An OTP comes on either the email or the phone number of the person. And whether that person has actually entered the OTP and accepted that agreement is tracked by the platform. And you are then given an audit trail. The most safe way, the best way to organize OTP-based signatures on your platform would be to maintain an audit trail of this nature. Some form of tracking where you can produce that log saying it's automatically tracked, it's an audit trail, and I don't have to lead any further evidence to prove its content.
All right. Oh, just one additional point. If I'm not wrong, like you stated that it would not have the presumption that is generally there for electronic contracts in case of OTP and other. Could you elaborate on that, please?
So if you were to see an Aadhaar e-sign or a digital signature, all you have to do is produce the electronic signature certificate provided by the certifying authority.
Right.
The rest, Section 85A and 85B of the Act kick in. So you will be able to show, if you're able to show that the signature on a document is an electronic signature, which you can easily show through the electronic signature certificate, it follows that one, the party has the subscriber named on that electronic signature certificate has signed that document, and two, that he has signed the document with the intent of accepting that document. So all you have to do is produce a certificate. If you want to make things as simple, things are not as simple when it comes to virtual sign. Let's say there was an exchange of emails, you may have to produce that exchange of emails, for example, to show that through OTP authentication, a contract was concluded. The simplest way to do it is through an audit trail, because then you will be able to rely on those paragraphs in Kundan Singh, etc., to say you don't really need anything further. The audit trail itself is proof of the fact that the agreement was accepted.
All right. Yeah.
In the alternative, you will have to fall back on things like emails or some sort of physical trail to prove that the other person has in fact accepted the terms and conditions.
Okay, all right.
The alternative is that a website cannot be entered at all without OTP authorization. The moment you enter the website, there's a pop-up and you have to enter an OTP. In which case, the very fact that this is the workflow of your website is also something that you can prove. So you will produce a printout of your website showing that pop-up, and you will say that this person cannot have entered my site or placed orders or done anything that you do on your website without having entered this OTP and given consent to the terms and conditions.
All right. Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you.
So yeah, anyone else wants to directly ask questions, just raise your hand and we'll answer it. Okay. So there is one. Still connecting. You may need to allow the app to access your microphone because I've sent you, given you the authorization. Yeah. Hi, Anush. You can ask Vinodini your question.
Hello.
Hi, Anush. We can hear you.
Hi. My question was that in the case of a document, electronic document of some antiquity, how would you, and say the electronic record whereby it the like device whereby which the electronic record was created is no longer in existence or no longer available with you.
Right.
How would you meet the requirements of Section 65B?
Okay, so let's first show 90A of the Evidence Act. So there are some presumptions that apply to documents, electronic records that are over 5 years old.
90A, yeah.
So if you were to have Patel, just go up, please.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
This is the state amendment. These are the state amendments.
That's right. So let me just read it out. I have it with me. So if you do have an electronic record which is over 5 years old, which you are producing from lawful custody, any electronic signature on that record is in that sense presumed to have been affixed by the subscriber.
Here it is. Yeah, here it is. Sorry. Yeah.
Now this, unfortunately, this section is not much of much practical use today because electronic signatures in law today are secure electronic signatures as defined by the second schedule to the IT Act. So it's practically only Aadhaar sign. And that as it is enjoys other presumptions. So this section is not of much use to you. The alternative is, today, if you have access to that record in electronic form on another computer, that would mean that you have created a backup of that document either on your network or through some other means, which would effectively mean that the document has been produced by a series of computers as defined under Section 65B3. So you can now give a 65B certificate for the record as it is currently on your computer today. And the device that you will describe in the 65B certificate will be the device that you're currently using. And you might want to describe, if you think that any controversy has been will be created on this, that this was backed up through an automatic process from one computer to another.
All right.
Thanks, Anush. Does anyone else have any questions? So Vinodini will be here for another few minutes. I'll just start wrapping up, but I mean, Vinodini and I will be here for a while. So if you have any questions, you know, we'll throw the floor open for the next 5 minutes if people have questions. So thanks for attending. Vinodini, thanks so much for making time. And
thank you.
In preparing this webinar, definitely taught me a lot about 65B. I hope audience and people who see the recording also learn as much. So just a slight announcement whoever's attending this or viewing the recording. If you found this useful, there's kind of more we have planned for you. We realize there's a real dearth of information or dearth of compilation and, you know, dearth of, you know, concise, easy to read information about digital contracts, digital signatures, and electronic evidence generally, right? So we're starting a new newsletter called the e-contract bulletin. It's a weekly bulletin designed to give you a clear and comprehensive understanding of the framework behind e-sign, e-contracts, and digital stamping in India, and of course electronic evidence as well. Every week, every Thursday, we will be answering one key legal question in a concise post. It could be a video. I mean, we'll gradually branch out into videos, podcasts, infographics, and things like that. And along with each update, we'll also send you case law, statutes, and regulatory updates that, you know, you can readily save in your research folders. So if you're interested in the recording email that you get, you will get two things. You will get three things. You will get the recording. You will get a copy of the ebook on 65B, which you can download and keep. And you will get a sign up form link for the e-contract bulletin. So if you sign up, you will get a form like this. You just give your name and email address. And every week, you will get a short, concise update about either e-sign, e-contracts, digital stamping, or electronic evidence, along with, you know, authorities like case law, statutes, and regulatory updates where necessary. So if you're interested, do sign up. A fourth thing we'll be sending you is a feedback form in the recording email. We would love it if you could give us feedback on how the webinar went, what we can do better in the future, and also what topics you may want us to cover in the future in this area of law. Again, you can also contact us. You can contact Vinodini at vinodinisrinivasan@gmail.com. You can contact Legality. You can contact me at contact@legality.com. So, you know, if you have any questions that were left unanswered at the end of the webinar and which you can't find the answer in the ebook as well, or you have questions on anything related to electronic evidence generally beyond 65B, happy to answer. So you can just email any of us at any point in time. And we'll, I think that's it. Vinodini, I think we'll just leave you guys with a small bonus. Vinodini had shared a very interesting judgment with me yesterday that actually will be useful for enforcing agreements, the Bombay High Court judgment. Let me just share that. Vinodini, this is the
2014
Gupte judgment.
So if you generally want to understand the law on how to prove a document, not in the context of electronic agreements, but general law, this is an excellent judgment to read. It is, I think, unreported, so you will have to find it on the website of the Bombay High Court. Suit number 236 of 2014.
Yeah, I mean, take it down, whoever needs to. Very useful. I wish when I was practicing, I had access to this judgment, or I wish I had found this judgment in my research. Right. Thanks so much, Vinodini. So we haven't received any other questions.
Yes. So I think
in the Q&A. So thanks so much. Thanks everyone for attending. Do spread the word, spread the recording to whoever you think this may be relevant to. Send the ebook out to whoever you think it may be relevant to. Do subscribe for the e-contract bulletin if you think it may be relevant to you. And of course, give us feedback on how you think it went and what you'd like to see us cover in the future. Thanks, everyone. I'll be ending the webinar now.
Thank you.
Thanks.